everyone. Thank you very much for coming to the National Math and Science Initiative meeting that we have here. I have a few slides that I'd like to go over. My name is Dr. Logue-Belden, I'm the superintendent here. We also have with us this evening Mr. Mort Orlov from National Math and Science Institute. So he'll be doing most of the presentation, but I do have a few slides that I want to show you, and actually it's a little bit of a quiz. Okay, so let's get started. Which major does Deer Lakes High School rank 46th in the greater Pittsburgh area? Anybody? SAT scores. Out of 115 schools, we are 46th. Which percentage of students in the class of 2017 is on track to be college and career ready? Which one of the following is not a predictor of college readiness and college persistence? That would be proficiency on the Keystone exams. True or false, over $530,000 is a lot of money. I think that is true. This is actually the amount that we are receiving in a grant from the National Math and Science Initiative. So we are absolutely thrilled. I want to thank the administrative team and the board for all of their support while we're pushing through this initiative. I think it's going to be a wonderful opportunity for our students, for our teachers, and just wonderful for Deer Lakes in general. So the total district investment in preparing students for success in AP courses, part of this grant, we have to pay $25,000 each year for 3 years. So when you think about that, $530,000, having to invest just a little bit is really worth it. What this is going to do for us, we're really going to be focusing on STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math. We want to make sure that our students are college and career ready. We want to make sure that graduation course requirements are modified. We're going to be paying for all of the advanced placement tests. We're going to have meaningful professional development for our staff, and we're going to have more rigorous course offerings and programs of studies here at the middle school and also the high school. So why did we pursue this grant? Well, having one-on-one meetings with community members, parents, board members, administrators, teachers, we know that we want to support the district in academic rigor, and that's what we hear with the Common Core. We also want to have more time on learning for students, not just memorization. We want to remove any barriers that the students might have to access these higher level courses. And lastly, we want to make sure that we support our teachers and give them the resources that they need to be very successful. So, without further ado, I'd like to introduce Mort and talk about the program. Thank you.
Can everybody hear me all right? Great. Well, good evening. I'm Mort Orlov of the National Math and Science Initiative, and it's a pleasure for me to be at Deer Lakes High School for my second visit. So this is, I'm getting used to it. I'm figuring out how to get here. But first, before I dive into the program, let me give you a little context that may assist you. And I'm trying to figure out the best way to do that for you. So let me ask a few questions. They may not seem connected, but we'll get there, so bear with me. How many of you have ever taken an advanced placement course? Just raise your hand. Okay, good, advanced placement, okay, good. So that's helpful. How many of you have seen the movie Casablanca? Okay, good, good. How many have seen the movie Men in Black, the first one, Men in Black, okay, all right, good. That's helpful, thanks. Just bear with me, we'll get there. So a little bit about my background. I'm with the National Math and Science Initiative. We have a slide a little further on that tells a little bit about us. We're a nonprofit, but I think it might be a little bit more helpful if I explain how I got to be here tonight. So I am the accidental educator in the room. I did 23 years in the United States Army and then jumped into education and was a high school principal just outside Boston, Massachusetts. So if you're looking for a Texas accent, you won't find one here tonight, at least with me. There may be someone else over here that's got that. In any event, I was actually running my high school, loving every minute of it, when I was approached to stand up the National Math and Science Initiatives program and affiliate in the state of Massachusetts. And I did that and ran that program for 6 years. We started in zero high schools, and when I finished, we were in over 60 high schools. And so I have been able to see up close the impact the program can have on teachers, students, and schools. And it's that context is why we're really pleased to be here tonight. We're pleased that we're in a group of schools in the area, and I'll show you that in a minute. We believe that this program will bring tangible benefits to the high school, but to the whole community as well. And the way I came to think about it was shaped by my realization as I had the opportunity to speak to folks in industry and higher education. I taught briefly at Boston University before being a high school principal. And the need to have students that are better prepared, that are capable of doing the work, that aren't in shock in their first year in college. College represents a huge transition from high school. It's a major financial event for most of us. And we want our students to be as successful as possible. Ultimately, we want them, of course, to be as productive as they can be in our economy. Someone once told me that if the United States were settled from west to east instead of east to west, Massachusetts would be a national park. Because there's no natural resources there, no coal, no oil. So when I think about my own community and the impact this program has had there, I believe that the strength of our community is, of course, in the work we do today, but I've got seventh grade, was it? Sixth, sorry. You look like a seventh grader. And then fourth or fifth? Okay. And our future is right here, really, right? And what we do with that. So let me jump into it, but that's what sort of brings me to it. And the things that I love about the program are really that it's all about student achievement, but it's teacher-driven. It's absolutely teacher-driven. And ultimately, I believe, if you can look over the time horizon, it's going to lead to a stronger community. So those are the key points. And again, I'm going to focus on primarily what we call our College Readiness Program, but some of the teachers here will also participate in our Laying the Foundation training, and that is for teachers that are teaching those courses that will lead to an advanced placement course. And so that will involve middle school teachers and potentially down the road could involve some elementary teachers as well. All right, let me press on. And look, if anybody has, so I'm not moving around, but I can move around if you want me to, but the camera is like here. But I'm happy to answer any questions. So if you've got a question, just raise your hand, wave at me, and I'm more than happy to stop midstream. And don't worry, I haven't forgotten about the quiz and questions I asked you. We'll come back to that. I noticed that we had a lot of hands go up around what is advanced placement. Sometimes there's some confusion around advanced placement, and certainly in my own personal experience, I know some of the concerns and challenges that we face as a community and certainly the school leadership faces. And that is, who should take an advanced placement course and what is an advanced placement course. So a way to think about this is that an advanced placement course is really that first semester course in college, but with a really big modification to it. And the big modification, which makes it so powerful, is that it's taught here in your high school by your teachers who have much greater knowledge of your student and more time with your student than you would see on any typical college or university campus. So there's almost no better way than to get a taste of the rigor of college work than by doing it in an advanced placement course. The one exception to what I've just told you is that if you have any students that are participating in foreign languages, if you've done 4 years of a foreign language in high school and you take an advanced placement course in a foreign language, when you go to college, you're going actually way beyond the freshman year, because a freshman year language, foreign language course would literally be French 1. So, the other piece in terms of this readiness and this transition is there are other benefits. And you can see them up on the screen, but I've got a couple of shots here that we'll go over. But one is that students can earn credits towards graduation from college, and they can earn advanced placement. But I will caution you that universities, our higher ed institutions, have to be business operating units. So I just caution you that you know they have little their limiting factors, so as you look to go into college, whatever that college is, and there'll be a website that will pop up here in a minute or a URL, you can actually do some research well before your son or daughter gets there to take a look at exactly what they will give in terms of credit and or advanced placement. Then you also need to think about how you want to apply those credits if you get them. Because I had a conversation I just learned recently that I think it's Penn State has a, has a limit. Some of you may know this, that when you reach junior status at Penn State, the cost of the tuition goes up. I haven't checked that personally, but that's what I was told. You might want to check that. So you just have to think about it, because the good news is you have advanced standing. That is good news, because it gives you one or two things. It means A, you can either take more advanced courses, which is good, or B, you can graduate sooner, which is really good. But it also means, in that scenario, that you may actually reach junior standing sooner, and thus, if in fact what I've been told is true, your rate may go up a little. So you just, there are some nuances to the system. Don't mean to overcomplicate it, but I just want to be as transparent as I can. All right, and then obviously the exam, let me speak to you about the exam. Having the students take the exam is critical. It's critical for us because, as you can see, we're making over a $500,000 investment here, and we need the data. I have to go back, and my team has to go back to our donors and explain what we've done with their money. And so we need the data so we know how we've done. And, but in addition to that, the district deserves to have that data as well, because it helps inform instructional decisions, it helps inform programmatic decisions, and it also helps the student. And I can, give you two different examples, but I think they're both powerful. So obviously the student earns a 3, 4, or 5 because the exam is graded on the 1 to 5 scale. As you can see up here, a 3 is typically the score at which you'll get credit or placement or both, right? Advanced placement beyond that first semester course. So obviously if the student gets a 3, 4, or 5, and let's use the scenario that I'm a student here at Deer Lakes, and I get a 5 in one of these AP courses. That's a really good score. That's the top score. And what's so powerful about that is it's the same exam as taken by all the public high schools in the United States that participate in the program, which is most, and private schools. And it tells a university that's looking at my transcript that exactly how I kind of stand relative to every other student in the United States. So extremely powerful that what it says about that student, about the teachers, and about the school as a whole. Now let's use the opposite example. What happens if I take the examination and I get a one? A one is the lowest score. You know, I might be a little disappointed, but I was once having a really heated conversation with my favorite social studies teacher, actually. And he was pointing out to me that, well, Mort, you know, worst case, a one is a powerful lesson in college finance. Because if you're getting a one on an AP examination, you need to have a serious look at your work habits, your study habits, your preparedness for college before you go spend a ton of money paying thousands and thousands of dollars to get a one. So again, two different scenarios, and I'm even going to talk about a two here in a few minutes. But any questions kind of about advanced placement? And our focus is on advanced placement math, science, and English courses. Though the advanced placement world, if you will, includes the social sciences, world languages, arts, and music as well. But the programs, the courses that we focus on are math, science, and English. All told, that's about 13 courses. Any questions before I go on? Actually, this is time to use one of my first quiz questions. So who saw the movie Men in Black, the first one? Okay, good. Okay. So there's a scene that I love in that movie, maybe because I was in the military, I don't know, but there's a scene where Zed has the all the young military officers, and he asks them, you know, why are you here? In other words, why do you want to join? Right? The young army officer pops to the position of attention and says, sir, because we're the best of the best of the best, sir. Will Smith pulls that table across the floor and distracts everyone. And my point in mentioning that scene to you is that I want to stress to you that advanced placement is a rigorous course. It's rigorous work. It's work worth doing. But it's not just for the best of the best of the best. Actually, I would argue that taking at least one advanced placement course should be in the interest of maybe half or more of the junior or senior class here. And that's consistent with your college going rate. I mean, you are sending a large number of students to post-secondary work. And even if someone told me, well, I'm going to graduate and go into the Army, I'd say, great. I said, I still think you ought to take one of these courses before you graduate. Because you may do 4 years in the military and then decide to do something else. And if you're going right into the workforce, if you're in health, in the health profession, and you've taken AP biology, incredibly useful, you know. And then almost anything would benefit from AP statistics. And I could go on and on, but I think you get the idea. All right, let me press on. These are the courses offered, currently offered, but then you see an asterisk down here. Where's that? There's statistics. We're going to aim to open AP statistics in the next school year. In other words, not September, but in 16-17. And French and Spanish, which fall outside this program, but are focus of the district. So this is a pretty good offering. So you've got the two English courses. There are two different English courses, language and literature. And the difference, in case you're wondering, literature is classic English literature. So poetry, 18th century, 19th century, 20th century reading, and really understanding the analysis of literature. Language is actually an incredibly powerful course. Language is argument, rhetoric, and really there's a mix of both nonfiction and fiction. So it's a course, quite frankly, that I wish I had had in high school. I like literature. I admire good literature. But I'll be honest and tell you that poetry was never really my thing. I mean, I got a little Robert Frost around the edges, but the truth was I had a wonderful 11th grade English teacher, and he loved poetry. I didn't love it as much as he did. But when I had the opportunity to really dig into language and composition, that is a course that can reach many, many students. As a matter of fact, I had one mandatory course for all my schools in Massachusetts, and it was not a math or science course. It was English language and composition. We consider it what we call a breakout course because it's typically juniors take that course, and they can then use it to open the gates for those to go on to take a whole range of courses, not just English literature. Obviously, the math, AP calculus, AB and BC, and the difference between AB and BC is the amount of material covered. So BC is covers almost enough material to be considered frequently. If you go look, and I'll show you where to look here in a few minutes, what the colleges offer is that they will offer you more credit because you're covering more material. Biology, chemistry, and physics. So there you go, good selection of courses. I've already kind of touched on the benefits, and there's a lot of research out. I will show you one chart here in a moment, but there's a substantial body of research out there that really points to the value of the rigor behind these courses and the exposure to that prior to getting into college, and what that means in terms of, again, a student being successful and staying in college. All right. Interesting, the time management. We hear this from the students. That's where we pull that from. When we interview students, they tell us all the time that, their executive functioning skills are challenged because, again, the rigor of the coursework. All right. I've already kind of suggested this. This is a set of bullet points around what college and universities, and again, I mentioned I taught at Boston University briefly, and I had the opportunity to work with the admissions committee, and I learned a great deal, and I basically learned that when you're on an admissions committee, there's no way you can know every high school in the United States. And every high school puts together a profile, Deer Lakes has a profile, that they ship to universities and colleges. But you could list your honors classes all day long, and I'm sitting on an admissions committee, I can't do anything with that data. Which is too bad, because you could have a perfectly wonderful honors course, but there's just no way to communicate that to colleges and universities. And the advantage, again, of the examination, of course, is that you've got a national exam, a national score. And the, let me talk about this. One of the things we know is sometimes students and parents get focused on GPA, grade point average, right? And certainly, better grades are important. Don't misunderstand where I'm going to go here in a second. But what matters is rigor. And so if you go through Deer Lakes and you do not take an advanced placement course, and you have a student, really, it could be almost the same student, background, experience, but they take a couple of AP courses. And maybe on one they get a qualifying score, 3 or higher, maybe on the other one they get a 2. But the college and university knows two things now. They know that student has shown, the one that took the AP, exams and courses, has shown that they can do college level work. And secondly, they know that student took a challenge and took some risk because didn't maybe do as well in one of the courses. And that tells a lot to the college. And I just share that with you because sometimes I hear from parents and from students, well, I'm worried about my GPA. And I appreciate that. I was telling the superintendent a story before we began. My daughter went through this experience. And I was a high school principal when she did it, though she wasn't in my school. She was very thankful she wasn't in my school when that happened. But she actually didn't do well in one of her AP courses. And, you know what? She didn't deserve to do particularly well. And when I'm talking about the course, let me be more specific. She didn't do well on a major project that impacted her overall grade in the course. So it did impact her GPA. It had a negative impact on her GPA. However, she did well on the exam. And I think the real moral of the story, though, is that I can look back now many years later, after college, after graduate school, and tell you that she's been successful. She's actually a teacher teaching AP English Literature now. So there is a far side to this. And it's tough when you're right there, though. I would just encourage you to talk to the leadership and the school community here about, you know, what's the best fit. All right, any questions about any of this before I move on? All right, I'm going to keep moving. So I'm going to throw my boss under the bus. He picked Ohio State for some reason and sent me to Pennsylvania. Not quite sure why he did that. But this could be almost any college in the United States or in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Sometimes I refer to you guys as the other Commonwealth. Hopefully that's okay. You guys can turn around for my place as the other Commonwealth. There's Virginia too, right? In any event, what I'm showing you here, and I'm going to step up. Can you still hear me? Okay, great. So what I'm showing you here is the minimum score required by each course and then the number of credits that a student can earn. And I'm showing you beyond just math, science, English, just to give you an example. However, this data changes, and it's unique to every university and actually each department in a university. And again, I think in my next slide, yes, there's the URL. And if you follow that URL, you're going to a College Board website where you can plug in your university, plug in the AP course you're thinking about taking, or maybe you've taken and earned a qualifying score, and you can find out what their policy is about credit and advanced placement. Any questions on that before I press on? Okay. Oh, this was the slide I was going to tell you that I mentioned. So this is an enormous study that was done, and it's we refer to it as the Dodd study, but it's actually several authors, 2008. And what they did is this is 300,000 participants in this study. And what you see is in blue, you see the fourth year GPA. And in gold, you see first year, both the college GPAs. And now, to my cameraman, I got to move a little bit. So. Here we go. So, completely intuitive, over here are the highest scores on the bottom, the highest scores on the AP exams, 4 or 5. Not surprising, the students also have the highest GPAs in college. I'm not telling you anything you couldn't have figured out by yourself. Down here, lowest scores are the students that did not take an AP course, nor were they exposed to dual enrollment, dual credit, where you're doing something with a community college. So why am I wasting your time with the slide? Hopefully I'm not wasting your time. The reason I'm showing you this slide is right here. This is the group of students that earned a 2. A 2 will not give you credit, will not give you advanced placement in college, at least not that I'm in front. I'm making sure there's an exception to something, but to my knowledge. Why am I showing this to you? Because as we expand access to these courses, which is one of our goals, and the superintendent spoke to that, there are some students that are going to get a 2. and I'm here tonight to tell you that's okay. Our objective is for every student to get a 3, 4, or 5. Absolutely our goal. Should be your goal, should be the student's goal. But I also will tell you and tell every single student that the journey here is just as important as the examination. The journey is just as important. Because when I get you in front of a great AP teacher who's got all this support, I'll show you that in a minute, who's doing all these things, the journey is incredibly valuable. Even if on test day you didn't quite nail that last essay or that last open response question and you ended up with a 2. Because guess what? You're still right there. So again, I just ask that you think about that, reflect on that, because we are going to ask students to stretch. Not maybe, not kind of, not sort of. We are absolutely going to stretch students. We think that's a good thing. We know. Better to do it now when you've got these great teachers, you've got these counselors that know your student, than to do it when they're in a lecture hall with 100 and some students, and they're just another pretty face. All right. So, the National Math and Science Initiative, just a little bit more about us. You know, basically, as you can figure out, we really are focused on success in college and career. We believe that that begins in our elementary, our middle school, and in our high schools. Now, I will tell you, this program is essentially a late high school intervention, but it's one that we know works. In other words, it's not too late for many, many students to take advantage of this. And tonight, I'm really, and you can see our mission statement, obviously, you've kind of heard from me on this. But I'm going to focus on the College Readiness Program. I've mentioned laying the foundation teacher training, which some of your teachers will participate in. I will not talk about our new Teach program. That's a higher ed program where we help prepare math and science majors to become teachers. That's a separate operation. All right. So this is our historic footprint. So again, I guess one interpretation of this slide is that I'm not here tonight to experiment on Deer Lakes High School. We feel pretty comfortable with the work we're doing. You can see Pennsylvania, the great Commonwealth. You'll see the number 2 there. Let me explain. Our first 2 schools in Pennsylvania, we started 2 years ago in Pittsburgh with Brashear High School and SciTech Academy, and had some very good success. We'll be adding 3 more schools in Pittsburgh, and we'll be adding 4 schools, which are listed in the upper right corner, including Deer Lakes High School, this coming year in our, what we call our cohort 8, meaning our 8th cycle of schools. And then where you see the really big numbers, just if you're curious, so in Texas, 139, that's where we got started. Let me go to the other Commonwealth, 100. Because we have a state program there, and we still have a state program there. Kentucky, Alabama, Virginia, Arkansas, Indiana, and Colorado are the other state programs. And then when you see a lot of these onesies, twosies, or fivesies in Hawaii, that's we've brought this program to schools that support our military installations. And so that's where we have a big initiative making that happen. All right, so what do our results look like? So let me jump right to the outcome. And every time I see my CEO, he looks at me and he goes, Mort, 10X, right? He's talking about math, science, geeky outfit. 10X, Mort. What he's talking about is he's talking about, on average, year-over-year increase for all public schools in the United States in AP Math, Science, English scores is a 6.8%. Our average, on average, for our schools, first year in the program, is a 68% increase. That's where the 10 comes from. So every time my boss sees me, more 10X, my job is to keep doing 10X. Recently, I told him I'm looking to increase that 10X. We'll see. Math and science, 7.8, 76%. We've broken it out by African American and Hispanic students, and then female students in math and science. So anyhow, what you see here is two things. One, we're consistent, and two, basically it's status quo in way too many high schools in our country. And what's going to be different here next year at Deer Lakes High School, no more AP status quo. And we're very excited about that. But you know, one year you could say, well, hey, Mort, that's easy. First year, you get here, you know, get everybody excited. But what's it look like over the long haul? So here's a three-year snapshot. So not surprisingly, the national average jumps to 23%. We're 128, 172, and you can see the rest of the numbers here. So we're pretty comfortable that this program can do this. And again, this is averages. So, you know, Deer Lakes, here's the challenge. I want you to beat all those averages up there, okay? There you go. Maybe we'll figure out a wager or something. Your superintendent seems to be interested in that, so we'll see. So now I'm going to talk specifically about Deer Lakes. So this one's a little complicated, though you can get the gist by just looking at the columns. So what I'm showing you, because one of the challenges is that you have about 700 students, right? 912-ish, not the 912-ish part, the 700-ish. So how do I compare you to, you know, Peters, what's it, Petertown Township, is that what it is? Getting to know everybody around here. Or West Allegheny. And the truth is, it's hard because they're much bigger schools. Well, there's a way to do that. And the way we do that is we talk about the number of qualified scores, 3, 4, 5, in math, science, English, relative to your entire junior senior population. Why junior senior population? Two reasons. One is it's stable. You don't see a lot of change in that population year to year. And you may be stable in all grade levels, but when I get into my urban settings, those numbers are all over the map. So one, it's a stable number year to year, year in, year out. Second thing is that's the primary population from which students will take these courses. Now, you will have sophomores taking some of these advanced placement courses. I hope so at some point. We'll work on that, right? But, so what we do is we say, what this means then is that at Deer Lakes, you're having 87 qualifying scores per 1,000 junior seniors enrolled. The national, or the Pennsylvania average is 135, and United States is 154. So what does that mean? Well, lower is not better, but it also, I want you to be, you can always check me on the numbers. To some degree, what it means is that we haven't been doing the things that we would like to do to get more students involved, to better prepare teachers, and to expand access, because some of this is just simple access. In this case, at Deer Lake, some of that is just test taking. Remember earlier I spoke about the test. So just share this with you, you can spread the word. Our expectation is that all students will take the exam. But that has not been the case in the district is determined. They've set some policies in place, they've made an investment to do this. We want all the students to take the exams. So I guess my point here is we have work to do, but I don't want everyone to leave the room beating themselves up over that number either. Give us a year and we'll see where that number is. But I have a hunch it's going to be a lot higher than it is tonight. So what's it? So this is math, science, English. Let's just take a look at math and science. And there is where our work really has to be. And again, some of this is test taking. Some of this is opportunity. So it's a number of things that come together. So this is not just strictly a I'm not making a strict qualitative judgment here, so don't overreact. But again, I have a hunch that we can easily get to here, and our goal over 3 years, quite frankly, is to get way beyond that mark. And I'm committed to doing that, my team is committed to doing that. From what I can tell, working with your team, is they're committed to doing it, and we will get that done. So how do we do that? I'm going to move again. Just checking with my guy. Can everybody hear me? Okay. So I think I need to go back to my third quiz question. So I can talk about the program with just this slide. We've got a few more backup slides. This is pretty much it. Because those numbers I showed you, you said, well, okay, how'd you do that? How do we do that? And the answer is right here. And I'm going to do a quick turn around this wheel. But I'm not, so I'm going to start with the first thing. The quiz, I asked about the movie Casablanca, and there were fewer hands up there, right? A few folks probably have some hair like mine. Wait, did you see it? Is there a man back there? No, okay, gives you a stretch. Well, if you haven't seen Casablanca, it's a great love story. You know, it's probably on Netflix or something. So, there you go. You can show it to the whole family. In any event, there's two scenes in the movie that I would, well, there's lots of scenes in the movie. And again, if you've never seen it, if you watch it, it will, you'll go, wait a second, I've heard that. So much of this, the script is built into our culture now. So one of the phrases is round up the usual suspects. Twice in the movie, this is a World War II era movie, twice in the movie, the French gendarme, in order to get the Nazis off his back, you know, issues the decree to his officers, round up the usual suspects. So what's that got to do with advanced placement? Well, what it has to do with advanced placement is that our first step is to get students into the classes next year. And these guys are working very hard on that right now. And you're part of that, and other people are part of that. And our message is that yes, the usual suspects will be there, but I want these guys to go two to the left, two to the right, two deep, and look at a student and say, no one may have ever told you this before, but we think you can do this well. And we want you to step up and try. And again, and there's actually a tool to help you. I won't go into the technical details. AP Potential, I think we perhaps spoke about that before. But so you may be hearing from your students, you may be hearing from the leadership here, but our goal is to really expand access and to break down any barriers that may be there. And there's sometimes very subtle barriers. I mean, we've seen it before where you talk to a student and the student might say, well, that's, you know, those are the smart kids. And one of the most powerful interviews I ever did with a student, we asked a group of students, but we asked them kind of one at a time, what did you notice differently about the program based on, you know, the size and the number and type of students that came into your class? We had this young woman who was just incredibly honest with us, and she said, well, first of all, I would have been in this class, it was AP Chemistry, I would have been in this class anyhow. And you know what? She would have. She's a hard-charging, bright young student, absolutely. She said, when these other students came into the class, we, meaning her group, we did not think they could do this work. And I said, well, what do you think today? And she was, again, right on, said, we were wrong. Not only could they do the work, but some of them did work better than we did. And that's a powerful social dynamic that can change the tenor of what people think about academic achievement and rigor in any high school. And so I think that's important because, you know, again, back to my earlier statement, our future, you know, I can work as hard as I can today for my children, and I work pretty hard for them, but what I really need to do is help set them up, ultimately work for us all. And so we want to expand that access, and we do that by getting students in. All right. So let me start with teachers. I told you we're all about student achievement. The way we get there is by teacher leadership. And you know, the superintendent is absolutely right. You know, kudos to the whole team for making the effort and doing the work, the prep work, the foundational work to get us in the door. You know, huge, huge effort and important work. And so congratulations, but now I'm going to tell you what's really important. What's really important is what the teachers do. And You've got some great teachers, and we're going to help them. The way we're going to do that is I'm going to start right here by the 11 to 12 o'clock position and tell you that we offer the teachers 7 days of professional development in a given calendar year. Now, to help you with that number, oh, and by the way, that 7 days is course specific. So if you're teaching AP calculus, you're teaching AP physics. 7 days, 7 days, right? Now, when I was a principal, I had 18 hours of professional development time in my institution. And I had to arm wrestle the assistant superintendent. And she was much smaller than me. I'm not very big. She still beat me almost every time. So the moral of the story is, and oh, by the way, we have mandates. I'm sure you guys have the same similar mandates from Commonwealth to Commonwealth. We've got to address this. We have to address that. That. So fundamentally, so much of our professional development time is not focused on the content and the instructional material that we need to get at to really move the needle for the teachers, to help the teachers. We will do that. We'll do 4 days this summer, right here in Pittsburgh. Then we're going to do a 2-day workshop in the fall. Same team comes in, so we get this continuity again in Pittsburgh. And then in the spring, we do what we call a mock examination meeting. I don't know where the term reading comes from other than in order to score an exam, you have to read the exam. That's the College Board's term for reading an exam, scoring an examination. We do two things there. One is we actually administer mock examinations to your students. And then we bring the teachers together, we calibrate on what it means, what a score looks like to a college-ready score. And then they work together as a group doing that. So they actually get what we call formative feedback. So in about 4 to 6 weeks before the exam, they can still make some adjustments. But they also get professional development. And then we have our stealth professional development, which is actually over here, right there. So I'll jump over here to the stealth professional development. So what's stealth professional? I gotta tell you something. Stealth professional, so I have my physics teacher. You can be my physics teacher right now. Outstanding. So I'm like, and actually you're perfect for this. Okay. Do you know what most AP physics teachers look like? They look like me. Okay? But in my travels, one day I came across an AP physics teacher that looked a lot more like you. Young people. And she was brilliant. So I went to my science director, who looked a lot like me, with even grayer hair. And I said, I want Lauren to do our first Saturday student study session. Right there. Okay? And he said, oh boss, that would not go over well. And I knew what he meant, because all the other physics teachers were men that looked a lot like me. And I said, well, I know where I'm going to be on Saturday. I'm going to be with Lauren, because Lauren is going to lead this session. She's amazing. And I went into that room, and so this is aimed at the students now. So we got all these students in there, but all the physics teachers are kind of on the wall, right? And boy, the body language was ugly. Lauren, I was worried about you. Okay? But you did a fabulous job, and within 20 minutes I knew we'd won, because the pens and the pencils came out. People were taking notes, meaning guys that look like me were taking notes. So that's what I refer to as our stealth PD. So we ask the teachers to join us on the Saturdays. They're off the hook. They're not on stage. We bring in national talent to lead these student studies. But they have another opportunity to reflect on their work by watching another great physics teacher present. And they go, oh, so here's a way to think about it. You know, when I'm just working here day in, day out, you know, any baseball players in here? Your softball team just won, right?
Yeah.
Congratulations. You're here for your softball team. Right? But you know, I don't know much about softball. They have different pitches, I assume, right? I don't know. I know regular baseball. Anyhow, so I'm here, and I've got a pretty good physics fastball. Are you with me? You know what I'm talking about? And I fire that fastball, and I think, boy, I've done it. But, you know, maybe I've got a student who raises his hand or her hand and goes, basketball didn't do it. Now, back in the day when I had my 14 kids, that I, the same 14 that I usually had, that fastball worked every time. But now I've got 28 kids. So I need a slider. But how do I learn how to do that slider? Well, I get to watch Lauren on Saturday, and I watch her, and she switches up and does a slider, and I go, oh, I got it. And that's some of the magic that goes on. So one way to think about the PD opportunities is actually something closer to 10. And then the final note on the PD is we also have laying the foundation. And a number of your teachers will do 4 days of training, and we offer it actually four days each of the year around, and this is for the teachers in courses leading up to the advanced placement courses. So, next course, we'll have some new teachers, and again, for those new teachers, we'll have mentors that are available, because frequently, back to my helper here, you're the only physics teacher in the building, or the only AP physics teacher in the building. So when you're stuck, what do you do? Right. So there used to be a TV show called Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, right? That's before your time. But anyhow, this is a big, you know, you can probably find it on Netflix, right? Better. So anyhow, you can you get a lifeline, you can call someone. So you'd actually have someone like this other woman I'm thinking of, her name's Amy. So you could call Amy and you say, hey, I tried this lab today and it did not go well. And you can have a conversation. So the mentoring has been hugely powerful, particularly for new teachers, but many, many teachers take advantage of it. And then we have a ton of resources. So we're gonna open some new courses. You saw AP statistics for 16-17. We're doing computer science. You've run it before, but it's been a while, right? Physics 1 is essentially a new course. It was new this year, new for the whole community. So we have a ton of materials so that you don't have to spend a lot of time trying to figure out what you're gonna teach, but rather you can focus on the actual instruction and where your students are. And then we'll go over to the student side. So I mentioned the student study sessions, and I'm gonna jump ahead here in a minute and show you about them. So we offer 9 Saturdays. It's 3 per content area. So we have 3 math Saturdays, we have 3 English Saturdays, and we have 3 science Saturdays, and they're not the same Saturday. And that way, if you are taking calculus and literature, or no, physics and literature, then you can actually do both. And if you happen to be taking 3 courses, like you're doing English language composition, you're doing biology, and AP calculus, just to make one up, or computer science in this case, you could spend 9 Saturdays. Now, what does that mean? Well, that's the equivalent of almost 2 weeks of instruction for just 3 of the Saturdays. So that would be the equivalent of 6 weeks of additional instruction. And it's high quality instruction. And we control the materials that we present. So we know it's consistent with what you need there. We provide an equipment and supplies budget. Over 3 years, it's about $35,000 to make sure that we've got materials. The district has to commit to the text, but we will do an awful lot of work around the other materials. We mentioned the exam fee subsidy. There's no excuse for a student not to take the exam. The district's going to pay a portion of it. We're going to commit to paying half. We, again, expect the student to take the examination. And then school support. So we have a person that will be the program manager. So when these guys have a question or if we need information, there'll be a point of contact. We also have an academic team, so if there's a specific question that a mentor can't answer or someone else can't answer, we can get the answer. We do some performance analysis, we do shared goal setting, so we will set a goal. Actually, we've already set it for you. I don't remember what it is off the top of my head, but we refer to it as your homework. So the principal has his homework and the team here, and you know, we're confident that, you know, but it's an open book exam, so we're going to help you with this, right? You know, we, again, it's a shared accountability. And then the final piece is we love to recognize success. So a student that earns a qualifying score will receive a scholarship of $100. And we also have a program to recognize teachers and whoever your designated administrator is, that person who does a ton of work on behalf of the program. So there's always somebody back there who has to do that work. I'm not sure who decided who it is. Yeah. I don't know. So that's in a nutshell the program. And I've got a few specifics. Again, this is a lot of text. I touched on it all. The one thing is we also ask the teachers make themselves available for some additional tutoring outside of the structured study sessions. Otherwise, I covered this. There's a mock exam I spoke about. Here's what the study sessions look like. They're about 6.5 hours. The meat of it is 4 75-minute sessions. 4 75-minute sessions. Here's an exam. Oh, I forgot to mention this. You know, on Saturday's tough. I don't know what time. How much time do you get up on Saturday? 8:30. So, yeah. So we actually need you seated at 8:30. So you'd have to get up a little bit earlier. Now, what if I told you that we were going to have a raffle, a gift card or something like that at the end of the session? You might come, right? All right. So we do have some prizes, and we'll provide some food for lunch. We provide materials, and we do help with all the planning. The big piece is that we also, we get presents. We have some marvelous folks that we can bring in. Here's an example, just to, okay, so what does it look like? So it looks like this, and we ask the students to register themselves. They go online, and they register for their sessions. Then we ask them to attend. Now if you ask me too much here, I'll get in trouble. But you get the gist. So here's sort of one of my former students, right, at a study session. Here, these are actual your dates for your first ones, okay? So we get started in the fall, but most of them fall after the new year as we move into the spring for a couple of reasons. One, to make sure that the teachers have covered a lot of the material, and two, of course, it puts us closer to the examination. And so we like to say luck is an opportunity, needs preparation, right? It's not accidental. It's not an accidental exercise. This is not an experiment. We will do experiments as part of the science courses, but this is not an experiment. Here's the rest of the dates, and again, the team here will make them available. The sites are in Pittsburgh. Now, there are 9 other dates that I am not showing you because there's another site. The challenge is, and I'm getting used to the geography here, so bear with me, but you guys have a lot of rivers, a lot of bridges. And what I do know is that the site is on the other side of the city, across several rivers. And so we kind of went with this combination. Originally, we thought we'd have a site down here, but for a variety of reasons, we didn't end up in the same school array that we thought we were going to. But we certainly didn't want to have that to be a reason not to have Deer Lakes in the program. So you do have a bunch of away games. But as the program expands, and we do intend to expand the program here, hopefully this will change so that you can host and we'll have home games and away games. In the event that there's a conflict, there's actually another location where students could conceivably go to make these study sessions. I will tell you that our goal is 60% of the enrolled students to attend any given Saturday study session. I will also tell you that if you ask anyone on my team, we believe that more is better, and we have some interesting data on that. Though I will tell you that for the very top students, sometimes they pick and choose. That's fine. But I would say for most students, more is better. So here's now all the details, the fine print on what I've already told you. I don't want to wear you out. We have a homework system. We don't mandate it. It's mainly focused on math and science, but that's another tool for the teachers, so they may be using that. Again, they're not required to use that. I've done it all. You've been very patient with me. I apologize for my lengthy presentation. But hopefully, I've set the condition for a couple things. One, this team needs your support, and you need our support. And so hopefully I've set the conditions for that to go on after I depart. And the second thing is, hopefully you've got some questions about, could be college readiness, could be the program, you know, local topography or anything like that. I'll turn it over to the team here. But what are your questions? Yes, sir.
With the weekend study sessions, how have you found conflict with other activities going on that same Saturday?
Yeah.
I mean, athletics, band, I mean, you got a million things going on.
You know, have you heard of ring dance? Yeah. That's what they have in the third Commonwealth, Virginia. They have these things called ring dance. And it's for juniors who are getting their school ring or something. I don't know. But my point in telling you about ring dance is I've had to schedule around ring dance on a regular basis. So we actually worked with the leadership to try to schedule around around dates. But what I've learned in doing this business is that, now remember, we're dealing with, in this case, for these dates, we were dealing with six high schools. There is no way with six high schools that we're not going to land on something. So, you know, this is where the trade-offs come. Now, the good news, though, if a student really wants to go, though, there's another set of dates. They just have to we'll to work the transportation.
If I could add something. Yep. I met with the other superintendents of the district, West Allegheny, Char Valley, City of Pittsburgh. We all looked at school calendars, typical over a couple of years, to see when things fell. We tried to avoid those types of dates. One of the biggest questions with all the districts is, what about sports and coaches who say you have to be in this practice, you have to be in this thing? Well, that's something that you're gonna, that we're all working out with our athletic directors. So that did come up.
Thank you.
Now, you didn't ask my opinion.
What's your opinion?
My opinion is, last time I checked, the athletic director worked for me.
Right.
Anyhow, that's my opinion. Of course, I caused my athletic director to have a heart attack one day when I was sitting there. I was just looking at the budget one day, and I said, you know, Frank, for all this money, I was looking at our football budget, for all this money, I could run intramurals for every student in this building. I thought he was going to die. I said, relax, don't hyperventilate. Anyhow. But you know, this is a challenge. Look, you know, I'm a New England Patriots fan. I have a great deal of respect for the Pittsburgh Steelers. Great team over the years. And we can talk about physics and Deflategate here in a minute. But let me press on. I understand the cultural, you know, pulls that can be there. The other thing you're going to run into, and I love this. One night I was presenting before a school board, and the vice chair of the school board going on about the Saturday study session and how her daughter had to get out of work. And I thought, oh, where's this going? And then she said, but it is more important that she figure out a workaround with her employer and go to the study session. And I said, I agree. And we know these dates. You know, you can bank on these dates. The only thing that will impact these dates is if we have a weather event. That does happen from time to time. Just like any other school activity in that sense. These guys, the way we work it is just like a sporting event. So the host, you know, makes the call, but these guys also have override. If they don't like what the weather looks like, then they override for their students. So we handle it just like anything else. You know, these are the trade-offs, but right. Hopefully there'll be more alignment. Great question. Any others? Yes, ma'am.
I have a quick question. So right now with the AP classes, I was not aware that you actually could go to class but not take the exam. So what would be the reason behind doing that? We're not going to do that anymore, I guess. But
no. So
it makes no real sense because, as he said, you have no benchmark for how well, A, that class is, or how well they're prepared.
So I will give you a couple reasons. One is that exams are expensive. I mean, a full cost exam is $90-some-odd, $92. So that's a real cost. The second is, one way of thinking about this from a student perspective is, well, I've got the course on my transcript, particularly if you're a senior, because this college is, you're going to be accepted into college before those scores. Now, remember, the whole point, though, is originally is, well, can I get credit and can I get to jump a course? But if you're really, if your primary focus is just making sure you get in, which is a legitimate focus, you know, then having it on your transcript is important. So those are two reasons. And then, you know, there's a third reason. It's a little more sensitive, but I want to be transparent and fair. And that is, you know, look, nationally there's been a huge discussion around use of data, teacher evaluation. I'm not in the teacher evaluation business. I have that t-shirt, it's packed up. These guys are in that business. But AP teachers have been way out in front historically on this, long before the rest of the nation ever got there. Because we've been publishing AP score reports for decades. So those teachers have been kind of out there by themselves long before anyone else got there. And to be fair, in many districts, they count wrong. And I don't know how it's done here, so I'm saying this with no knowledge of historically how the counting is done. What do I mean by counting wrong? Let me give you an example. Matter of fact, I know a whole state, I won't mention the state. There's a whole state with the count wrong. In any event, what they do is they say, what we care about and what we're going to measure is the percentage of AP students that earn a qualifying score. That is a disaster. Now, I have an idea as to how they came by that. Because I could well imagine if I were an assistant superintendent 15 years ago, we add our first AP course, I got a report to the superintendent and the school board on it, and I don't know anything about it. So I go to the college board and kind of do my homework and ask the question, well, how does the college board report on AP results? College board reports nationally at the state level by telling you what percentage in AP calculus nationwide earn a qualifying score. 68%. Made that up, but something. And they'll also tell you for AP calculus that the national exam average is a 2.94. So the minute you take that, though, and put it into a building or put it into a district, it's a disaster. Why? Because I'm not a dummy. If I gotta meet a number like that, I can meet that number by the look on my face, my summer work program for my students who wanna be in my AP calculus class, and my first quiz. I'll have them run into the guidance counselor in a heartbeat. And that's exactly the opposite of what we want. We wanna go, instead of like that, we wanna go like this. I've walked into buildings where they said, hey, Mort, look at this. AP literature, 15 students took the exam, 15 qualifying scores, most of them fives, we're great. And I'll say, I don't know that. And I'll say, actually, that tells me we need to triple the size of the program right now. So how you count matters, and there's a lot of tricks, and I try to be as honest as I can, straightforward with you about my numbers, but there's a lot of tricks that get played with numbers. And lots of reasons why students don't test or why teachers aren't incentivized to have students test. But we've changed that in this dynamic. Yes, ma'am?
I have a couple questions. Question number one is, of the 530,000, you had a breakdown of the equipment being 35,000.
Yep.
What is the duration of the grant and what is the breakdown of the grant?
So, I can provide that to you. It's actually it's in the MOU, which is a public document, right? Once you guys sign it, so and you sign it, right? So I can look it up on my machine. But I would tell you it's a three-year program, so divide that over 3 years. And that number, again, to be transparent, includes our overhead and what it takes for my staff to come out and support these things. But it also covers the teacher training. We pay for the whole cost of the training. For example, if we're not running the computer science course here in Pittsburgh, which I don't think we are, then we're going to travel that computer science teacher to where he or she needs to go to get that training. So, you know, it's soup to nuts, pretty much. There's a stipend for the teachers. I didn't cover the stipend for the teachers, but there's a stipend for some of their time that's out of school. And, you know, so there, it all adds up. You know, I can just give you some big chunk numbers off the top of my head if you want, percentages.
After the 3 years, is it an evergreen? Is it a renew? What do they do after the 3 years?
Right, so actually, that's a great question. And I would encourage you all to begin thinking about that now. And what our goal is, so the answer is, it depends. I hate giving you that answer. So let me give you an example. I have schools that are now in their fifth, sixth, seventh year of the program because their donor has agreed to continue to fund them. I have schools that at the end of 3 years, it's, hey, congratulations, good job, we'll see you later. And then we are working on rolling out what we call a sustainment plan so that there would be a way for you to access continued materials and support. Obviously, there's a cost associated with that. And we're trying to get that cost into a box that is somewhat doable. We have districts that have figured out ways to finance parts of this. I mean, the truth is, in and of itself, as it's purely configured here, I've not met any district, there's only been a couple districts that I've met that have found the wherewithal to continue doing that in total. But what I have observed is that there are places where you can be selective on the components after 3 years, and with a public-private partnership, maybe you've got some donor local and some district money, and then you can get on a good sustainment level. The other thing that I would tell you, though I don't have a slide to show you tonight, is that after those 3 years, typically we do not see a big drop-off. So here's a way to think about it. Very few things in life are straight line, right? So if I were to chart your performance to date, if I go back 10 years, it's going to look, qualifying score performance, it's going to look like some sort of wave, right? Sign. And what we do with this program is we take that, imagine the top and the bottom, you know, peak and the trough, and we take that whole band and we go way up like this. So after we finish, there will still be some of this going on, but not this. We very seldom see that, if that's helpful.
Second questions concern these study questions. Are they progressive? So English 1, 2, and 3?
Yes.
Okay.
Right. So the question is, you know, do we kind of, right, it's not repetitive, we move on to additional topics. And we have a process by which we're talking to the teachers, we're talking to the mentors, and to try to fine-tune what each session needs to look like.
And then are there breakouts? So for science, where you have AP Biology, you have AP Physics, are there breakouts?
Absolutely. It's by course. And in some of our bigger sessions, it even goes beyond course. I didn't show it here in this example. There we go. So here, I'm showing you by course, right? But we have locations where we have hundreds of students coming. And we'll actually, there'll be a menu. There'll be, instead of just four chemistry topics, we might actually run eight chemistry topics. So the student couldn't even get to all of them. The student goes to the topic they think they need that reinforcement. So this is not, we're not presenting new material. That's our rule of thumb, is to not try to do new material, because that would be unfair to a student who couldn't be there. And that's not our role. So we try to present material that's already been touched on in some shape. Does that help? Those are great questions. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
How do you pick the right teachers?
How do we pick the right teachers to instruct the courses? So first part of my answer to that is that I don't pick the teachers. That's a leadership decision over here. Secondly, let me tell you about the casino model and the army model. Okay? So one of the beauties of this program, one thing in the budget is I anticipate future growth. So I'm actually anticipating that we're going to add teachers to the program. I don't know that yet. I hope we do. So now back to the casino and the army. So the casino and the army model comes from this. I was an army guy, right? I learned a long time ago that one of anything grows. I was also a urban principal. One of anything leads. So using the sports analogy, how do we build the bench? So if you have enough students to run two sections of AP Biology or AP English Language and Composition, I strongly encourage our school leaders to have two different teachers teach. And we will train, we'll make that investment to train both of them. But ultimately, the decision as to who teaches resides over here. Is that? But we're willing, you know, it can be a new teacher, a new to AP teacher. It could be a veteran teacher. It can be, in some cases, we have brand new teachers. We've seen it all and been successful with all. That doesn't mean all teachers achieve the same level of success, but I would say programmatically, I can give you examples of the one that jumps to mind is I got a call, panic call from one of my favorite principals a number of years ago. She said, "Mort, my English language teacher just left. She had a good English language teacher. Small school, smaller than you guys. So unfortunately, again, one of anything. Oh, and I didn't tell you the casino. So the casino model is you take your best horse, bet all your money on your best horse. Right? You got the Belmont numbers, right, on Saturday, and you win big. And you know what? The mathematicians will probably back me up and say, yeah, that's a way to win. I'm not a big fan of the casino model. Yes, it may get you the absolute best number of scores, but I don't think it's the best development long term for school. So hence I'm the army. In any event, back I got this panic phone call, Mort, I got three resumes. Will you help me out? Sure, I'll take a look at the resumes. And one of them was a guy who had never taught before. And I said, what do you think of this guy? But he had been an editor of a paper or something. She said, well, he's really bright. I said, oh, I like that. And, but is he training? She said, I think so. Well, I'll tell you what, if you tell him that he's going to take this job, then I'm going to send my content director down there for 2 or 3 days. He's going to do everything she tells him to do all year long. No job. He agreed, and we did, and he smacked it out of the park. First year ever teaching. So, you know, I've seen it all. So I'm an optimist, right? Glass is half full. But again, those decisions over here. I don't want to speak for you guys, but
some of the AP courses we're transferring were honors courses prior at the high school. For next year, of course, we want teachers that have some exposure to the upper level courses. So a lot of the honors teachers are transferring over to the AP to get that training for next year. Of course, we do have some experienced teachers that have been teaching AP already for several years are also those teachers as well. So we do have a mix of some newer folks and some experienced folks that will be teaching those courses.
That's good. That's very typical of what we see. Yes, ma'am.
So once the training is complete, throughout the course, I'm wondering, is there something in place that monitors the pace of the course, that our training is on pace? And
that's a great question, and that's one of our biggest challenges. The way we do that is with the mentor. So if you have a mentor, that's how. Now, if you don't have a mentor, then, it's harder for us to do that, quite frankly. It's really up to the teacher to communicate with us whether there's an issue. In some locations, we have assessments in place. We're not going to deploy them here because it gets a little more complicated for a variety of reasons. But where we have the mentors in place, and we estimate that about half the teachers will probably want and use a mentor, and that gives us a pretty good read. And then remember, we're going to see them at the 2-day in the fall, and then we're going to see them again. And the other thing I didn't mention that's not on the slide, we also hold webinars. Now, they're completely optional, but in the evenings, we'll do webinars several times, 4 or 5 times a year, and teachers can check in, and sometimes we hear from them about issues that they're struggling with or pacing. And we have pacing guides. I should have mentioned that right up front. You didn't actually ask me what materials we had, or what method we have for checking or something. So we actually have pacing guides, but of course that assumes someone used the pacing guides. Right? So, this is a coalition of the willing. As I said, kudos to the leadership. They were the first ones to the door as a coalition of the willing. You guys, kudos to you for joining tonight. Let's see this guy who mentioned he's back on and on and on. You know, kudos. Now we got to bring more. more folks take part in. And it's really, that's, you know, that's the piece that helps move along. Yes, ma'am.
I guess I have a follow-up question, but Dr. Logue-Belden, I guess, is going to have to answer this one then.
Okay.
Is there any way within the district that we can check on the pacing?
That's with the leadership. We do that already. That's what we're trained to do as principals, superintendents. So the administration and their daily duties will, like every other teacher in the district, make sure that, you know, pacing is set.
Yes.
How is this going to affect the middle school, the kids going into middle school, like with this new AP courses being offered for the kids going into like 6th, 7th, 8th grade?
So there,
yeah,
I can touch on that, and then I'll defer to the leadership. But there are two key points that would be my takeaways tonight. One is that we are going to have training opportunities up to 12 days over the 3 years for middle school teachers in our Laying the Foundation. And those, that training and those resources are aligned with these AP courses. Secondly, and now this now really falls, you know, to the leadership, but there's an opportunity here now because there's an opportunity for dialogue and work now around this alignment, around the expression I use. So again, I had an urban high school. I was concerned about what's my academic engine, what's driving the train in my building. And but then as I got better at doing this, I learned that I'm really captive to the pipeline. I'm at the tail end of the pipeline. So that middle school principal is like gold to me. What he or she is doing is so critical to my work. So then I'm down mixing it up with the eighth graders trying to figure out how do we make that transition work. And it's those conversations and the work that can be done, and that's outside of our scope, but the leadership here knows what I'm talking about. It's that work that can really drive the rigor and the understanding about the need for that rigor all the way down into the lower grades. Does that help a little bit?
Yeah.
You guys want to, did I kind of get the gist?
Sure. If I can steal a couple.
Please.
I'm glad I see a lot of middle school faces. That's absolutely wonderful. And one of the things that we jumped on as far as the initiative goes is exactly what Mr. Love just talked about. That they recognize that the AP scores, the AP participation is wonderful, but it has to start down below. So the program is very aptly named Laying the Foundation. So what they're going to be doing is providing our teachers at the middle school level those trainings, that professional development, to ramp up those courses to increase that rigor. So hopefully, if you did not, if you are a middle school parent, parent of a student going into 6th, 7th, or 8th grade, there's some papers out on the front table. The high school had a little bit of a head start on us. They've always had AP courses in place. They've always had honors courses in place. Middle school never had that opportunity. The fact that we can do that now is absolutely outstanding. Okay? So as they offer their course registrations, they already had some of those things in place. We did not. Okay? So here we are getting involved in this program, seeing this great opportunity. So now you as parents have an opportunity to sign your son or daughter up for those advanced courses in science, in English language arts, which at our levels, language arts and reading, okay? And then the math courses, which we've had some advanced courses in math before, but now those teachers are gonna get a little bit more professional development. And you can't get too much. So hopefully you saw those handouts. There's 5 pages out there on the table. You will not need all of them. First one's just another letter from me kind of explaining everything. The next 3 that you need to take a look at depend on what grade your son or daughter is going into. There's a sheet if you're going into 6th grade, 7th or 8th grade. Okay? And it's just a course request form. What's going to happen is every student's going to kind of default to what we consider the academic level, you know, the regular class, if you will. Okay? By filling out that course request and choosing an advanced course, maybe choosing multiple advanced courses, we add your son or daughter to that section. But I need that information back, obviously. If you want to sign your son or daughter up for advanced science, you fill out advanced science, you turn in that form, they're in advanced science and academic everything else. Say, if that makes sense. Okay. Now, we do have a little bit of an expectation. We don't want to set the bar too high, but we also want to make it realistic. Okay. So we found that for our math courses, 88% seems to be a nice threshold. Now, does that mean if you have an 85 that you're not going to make it in an advanced course? Absolutely not. Okay? But that's a conversation that you and I and your son or daughter and the teacher may have to have, because as Mr. Orlov said, the rigor is there, the challenge is there, and he used the term that you're going to hear a lot of is your son or daughter gets order. It's executive function. Okay? It's not about the content of the material. The curriculum is going to stay the same. The curriculum A to Z doesn't change in that advanced course. What changes is it's going to accelerate a little bit, it's going to go deeper in certain topics, and we're going to enhance it with some writing, because AP is a lot about writing. Okay? So those executive functions are your time management, your study skills, your critical thinking skills, okay? Not the things you learn in a textbook. There's not a multiple choice test for those skills. Okay? So those are the things we're going to have to help your kids with. Okay? And we just know that going in. Doesn't mean they can't succeed. We just might have to work. Does that make sense to everybody? Any other questions for me before I sit down? Yes.
What's your number for those classes to run them?
I'll run it with what we need to run it. I mean, obviously there's always magic numbers. The districts has always kind of looked at that 10 number. I hope we exceed that. I hope my challenge is how many sections am I going to make? But my anticipation, I'm not going to have too few. My anticipation is my challenge is going to be I have so many I got to figure out how to make one. So. That's the AP. That's the AP moving on. Okay, that'll start once they get to high school and the extra with AP courses themselves.
Okay. No, great. And that was a great question. Earlier there was a question about what happens after the program, what sustainment looks like. And we at the National Math and Science Initiative are very interested in doing our best to figure that out as well, to make it affordable and again, sustainable. The other piece, though, which I love from that question is, and I frequently use this with superintendents and principals, is you ought to try to pick our pocket. How do you leverage this program? And, I mean, in and of itself, it's a marvelous program. You can tell I'm a true believer. But actually, there's a lot that can come from the program beyond what I showed you this evening. And it's really, open to the imagination, the effort, and the collaboration that occurs. And this is one of the few events that I've been to where we have the elementary principal, the middle school principal, and the high school principal in the same room. I'm really impressed by that. And that's a good sign. And if this is a beginning, and we get the teachers doing the same piece. Because the truth is, to go back to my physics, now there's four physics courses, okay? But two of those physics courses are calculus-based. And calculus and physics, in this case, are absolutely captive to the pipeline. And the work that is done starting in elementary grades, but really ramping up in the middle school around algebra, and even some of the science work, really will help define a few years down the road what we see at the high school. And so, if you say, well, Mort, what specific programs and courses do you have for that? I don't have a lot, other than we have a program manager, though, who's more than happy to participate and help, kind of on an advisory role is the way to think about it as we go through this process. And this is very much individualized to the district, to the schools involved. But again, I don't know where we're going to go with this entirely, but I will tell you that I'm really encouraged standing here tonight by what I see. So great question. Obviously, lots of work ahead of us. So I've taken a lot of time. I will stay as long as folks want to stay, but you don't have to stay because I'm standing up. Please. And Superintendent, I'd love to bring you back up here and thank you for giving me this opportunity. Again, it's an honor for the National Math and Science Initiative to have a partner here at Deer Lakes High School, and actually I'm going to say the whole Deer Lakes School District. This is very exciting.
Thank you very much. We're very excited. This is a new thing for us, and there's not a lot of schools in Western Pennsylvania that have the opportunity to do this. So I really wanted the Superintendent to bring something that you've been asking for as parents, as teachers, and as administrators. We have a fantastic team of people, and I think it's going to be a really, really exciting time for us. So work with us, please ask us questions. It's a work in progress, but very excited. I can't thank our administrative team enough. Can't thank the business manager enough. I'm always asking him to find me money for things. So thank you very much for all of your help. Thanks.